In the summer of 2021, for the first time in U.S. history, a modern military aircraft landed on a U.S. public highway designed only for automobiles. Four A-10 Warthogs and two 146 Wolfhounds landed and then departed from Michigan Highway 32. But that wasn't the most impressive part. The organizers somehow managed to find a smooth strip of road in Michigan, free of potholes. These highway landings were a part of Exercise Northern Strike 21, and they were performed to test a backup plan. One of the effective tactics of war is to bombard your enemy's airfields, which not only can hinder counterattacks by the Air Force, but it can also disrupt the military supply chains that are dependent on the Air Force's cargo planes. These massive airplanes can airdrop anything from supplies and Humvees to delivering helicopters anywhere in the world. Of course, losing the ability to operate airplanes also has a huge psychological impact. This is why these highway landings were being performed for the first time in the United States. But this wasn't the first time that highways had been utilized as backup airstrips. During the Cold War, in the fear that Soviets may bomb and destroy existing airbases in Europe, NATO conducted a military exercise known as Highway 84, where they turned a section of the Autobahn in Germany into a landing strip. The idea was to rapidly convert predefined sections of the road into a serviceable strip. A temporary air traffic control tower was set up to facilitate the landing, servicing, and takeoff of 370 various airplanes, anything from smaller fighter and ground attack airplanes to massive fully loaded cargo planes. Of course, with the end of the Cold War and the dissolution of the Soviet Union, they never had to use the Autobahn as an operational runway. But this is currently happening in Ukraine, or did happen, if the war is over at the time that you're watching this video. Ukrainian airplanes have been observed landing and taking off from roads. It's a lucky coincidence that during the 2 years leading up to the 2022 Russian invasion, Ukraine upgraded and built more than 8,700 miles of roads under what's known as a large construction national program. But if an airfield was in fact bombed, the first step in the recovery process is not to get the construction crew out right away to start repairing the damage. This is in fact one of the early steps in getting the runways operational again. So what are those? Those are explosive time fuses. And yes, the guy is swinging them before getting them set up on the airfield. These explosives are in fact going to help rebuild an already bombarded airfield in the most American way, by exploding the explosives away. After an attack, there could be unexploded ordnance and other hazards present in the airfield. Typically, the Explosive Ordnance Disposal Team, or EOD, is the one in charge of removing and discarding any explosives that may have been left behind. I must say, these guys have an interesting way of making their problems disappear. Of course, you want to be quite far from that explosion, because you never know where things are gonna end up. The thing is, collecting unexploded ordnance is a time-consuming task, not suitable for an airfield that has been hit and needs to be repaired as soon as possible. The solution to this is Rapid Explosive Hazard Mitigation, or REM. The first step for REM is to clear large swaths of ordnance quickly. This is done with the help of heavy equipment. To accomplish this, industrial equipment platforms are combined with EOD attachments. I'm not gonna lie, these machines look kind of funky. I couldn't find their actual names, so I took the liberty of giving them some nicknames. This is the Little Scruffy. That is the Ordinansaurus, always hungry for a shell. This is the Honorable I Suck Bombs. And my favorite, the Not My Problem Blower, which just pushes the bombs away for other machines to collect them. Given the risks involved, some of this equipment can be remotely operated to keep the personnel safe in case of an unexpected explosion. After the remote mass mechanical clearance has collected what they could, anything left behind needs to be neutralized. This is done with the help of small explosives to target small ordnance that cannot be manually dealt with. There are four components for this setup: the igniter, the safety fuse, the detonator, and the explosive charge. To create a time fuse, the igniter is attached to one end of the safety fuse, with the detonator attached to the other end. Once a sufficient number of these time fuses have been assembled, all team members, except for the team leader, are equipped with time fuse setups that are placed around their necks prior to the start of the walk. Some team members like to swing them around to get them straightened out. The team then strolls down the runway, looking for unexploded ordnance. Upon reaching any hazard, team members simply pull the igniter, which sets off the safety fuse. They then insert the detonator into the explosive charge and place it close to but not touching the ordnance. This allows the REM team to quickly neutralize the area before the repair team comes on site to do their work. It's worth noting that unlike traditional explosive ordnance disposal, REM is fairly straightforward. A person just needs to take a 5-day course and attend refresher training every 6 months in order to remain certified. This allows non-EOD personnel to be quickly trained to perform explosive operations in order to supplement response capabilities during wartime recovery. With the explosives out of the way, it's time for the raider team to come in. The Rapid Airfield Damage Repair Team, also known as Raider, is in charge of getting an airfield back to a fully functional state after a major airfield has been attacked. Not having to worry about unexploded explosives, a team comes in first to remove any debris from the site. Once that's done, they mark the areas that require to be fixed, and then begin cutting the damaged area around each crater using a massive diamond saw. Each section is broken into pieces using a bayonet breaker. Then all the debris is removed from the site. The excavated areas are backfilled using various materials, including crushed limestone, and then are packed. A lightweight deflectometer could be used afterward to ensure the backfill has been properly packed. Finally, a cap is added on top. This could be done by pouring a rapid-setting concrete on top of the backfill. Only 2 hours after the concrete sets, aircraft can resume operating over it. Another option is to use a fiber-reinforced polymer matting system, which is in turn secured to the ground. In either scenario, the repair is load-tested to ensure that it can handle the appropriate amount of pressure before the airfield can resume operation. The repaired section can handle 9,000 PSI, which will accommodate about 3,000 airplane runs that will come through this airfield. The entire radar process can be performed on a single crater in about 3.5 hours, and the entire airfield operating surfaces could be fixed in under 7 hours. All this said, there has been some criticism about these training exercises not being realistic enough, because bombs would create much larger craters than these. A realistic training scenario for the raider team will be to fix the craters on the streets of Detroit.